Welcome back to the Organic Chemistry course for undergraduate students. Let me briefly introduce to you the plan of the current lecture. First, we will deal with the concept of covalent bond length. It will help us to describe several ways of defining the atomic radius. The next topic for today's discussion will be the polarity of a covalent bond. Using this feature, we'll have pretty enough information to talk about the dipole moment. Okay, now we know enough about the Lewis structure from our previous video, and we can move forward to discussing the atomic radius. We remember the basic atomic structure. To be more specific, the atomic nucleus consists of protons and neutrons, while electrons form the so-called electron density that surrounds the nucleus. On the slide, you can see that electrons are located on the orbitals, and it may seem that the distance between an electron and nucleus remains constant and is well defined. However, it is not true. The picture on the slide is just a model. In reality, we cannot know the exact position of an electron. It means that we know only some region in space around the nucleus, and we can predict the probability to find an electron in this region. I hope it is quite obvious from the figure on the slide that the more dots we see in some region, the higher is the probability of finding it there. And of course, the farther from the nucleus, the less is the probability to find an electron there. Undoubtedly, it is a very simplified description, but it is sufficient for us now. Such behavior is the result of the quantum mechanical nature of an electron. If an electron movement could be correctly described with classical mechanics, then the representation on the slide was a good model, and based on it, we could have predicted the radius of an atom as the distance between the farthest electron and atomic nucleus, just as it is shown on the slide right now. In reality, the situation is much more complex, so we need to develop some more sophisticated methods to define the atomic radius. Scientists have created several widely applicable models for this purpose, so let's discuss them one by one. The first definition of the atomic radius applies only to the simplest chemical structures, namely atoms or ions with only one electron. This radius is called the Bohr radius. It is named after a brilliant physicist, Niels Bohr, who published an article about the atomic structure back in 1913. In this paper, he has proposed several ideas that lie at the heart of Bohr's atomic model. If you are interested in reading this fundamental paper, check the specific thread on our forum. It is uploaded there as a PDF. And no worries, the math that is used there is more than trivial. The Bohr radius symbolized A is the mean radius of the orbit of an electron around the nucleus of a hydrogen atom at its ground state. It is a very important physical constant, and its value can be seen on the screen right now. Unfortunately, in chemistry, we don't use it anymore for the determining of atomic radius. As I have mentioned before, the main limitation is that this radius is valid only for one electron systems, whereas the organic molecules contain hundreds of them. Let's move on to the more useful definitions. The second definition is named after another renowned physicist, Johannes Diederik van der Waals. You probably have already heard about the van der Waals forces and van der Waals equation of state during inorganic chemistry lectures. The definition of atomic van der Waals radius is fairly simple. The van der Waals radius of an atom X is half of the distance of the closest approach of two non-bonded atoms of X. So let's illustrate this concept using the following example. Now on the slide you can see two S8 molecules and their 3D model that somehow resembles a crown. At room temperature, these molecules form a solid substance. Here is the corresponding crystal structure. However, we can easily evaporate it, obtaining the gas phase. The S8 molecules move rapidly in gas and repel each other due to electrostatic forces between their electron shells. The half of the distance of the closest approach of two S atoms that belong to the different molecules is their van der Waals radius. On the slide, it is colored red and denoted as RV. There are various experimental and theoretical techniques to determine or measure the van der Waals radius of an atom, but we will not discuss them today. You just need to understand the definition and remember that both atoms are not covalently bound to each other. It means that they don't share electrons at all. Well done! The last atomic radius definition for today is the covalent radius. To define the covalent radius of an atom, we need to define the covalent bond length first. The covalent bond length between atoms A and B is equal to the distance between their nuclei. Yeah, it's that simple. Now on the slide you can see several organic molecules and some of the covalent bond length that are predicted with quantum chemical calculations. The typical units for bond length are angstrom, which equals to 10 to power of minus 10 meters, and picometer, which is 100 times smaller and corresponds to 10 and to power of minus 12 meters. Pause the video and inspect the given bond length. Now we have enough knowledge to define the covalent atomic radius. It is just half of the internuclear separation in a homonuclear XX single bond. Here on the slide you can see the halogen molecules, their covalent bond length and covalent atomic radii. I would also like to mention that the covalent atomic radius is also smaller than the corresponding van der Waals radius. Here on the slide you can see two tables. The first one represents the covalent atomic radii, and the second one provides the van der Waals radii for the same atoms. Well, I guess these tables perfectly illustrate my last statement about the relations between these two types of atomic radii. We have covered pretty much of the new information for today. I hope everything is clear for you now. And if not, you know where the comments are, and don't forget about the webinars. You're welcome to ask all the questions in the specific threads on our forum. One limitation of representing electrons as dots and covalent bonds as two dots shared between two atoms is that the shared electrons always appear to be equally shared, but it's not always like this. Let's move on to the next to last topic for today. Take a look at the Lewis structure of the HBr molecule that we discussed earlier today. I hope you remember from your high school chemistry classes that bromine is more electronegative than hydrogen. For those of you who don't remember, here is a brief recall. Electronegativity is a measure of the tendency of an atom to attract a bonding pair of electrons. There are several ways of calculating the electronegativity of an atom, and the most popular one is the Pauling scale presented on the slide. The higher number is, the stronger an atom pulls the shared electron pair. It is obvious that bromine pulls the electrons to itself much stronger than hydrogen due to higher electronegativity. It means that the electron pair, of being more precise the electron density, is not equally distributed between hydrogen and bromine. It is concentrated more on the bromine atom. But the Lewis structures don't give any clue about this unequal distribution. By the way, chemists and physicists call this phenomena polarization. Now we need to recall in our own memory a very important fact: the electrons are negatively charged. And if there is a much higher probability to find them in the proximity to bromine, it is partially negatively charged. On the other hand, the hydrogen atom should have a positive partial charge of the same magnitude, because the overall charge of the molecule is zero. It means that if we sum up all partial charges of the atoms in a neutral molecule, we should obtain zero. Sometimes we are not really interested in the magnitude of partial charge. Instead, we just want to indicate that the electron density distribution is not equal. In this case, we just use these deltas with corresponding signs, as shown on the right-hand side now. Another way to show the polarity of the bond is to use arrows, as shown on the left-hand side. So let's illustrate the concept of bond polarity using the previously discussed molecules. Here's an oxygen molecule O2. It consists of the same atoms with equal electronegativity. So the electrons are pulled with equal strength, thus the bond is nonpolar, meaning that electrons are equally distributed between atoms. And here's the phosphorus chloride, PCl3, from our previous video. P is less electronegative than chlorine, meaning that electrons are pulled stronger by chlorine. It leads to the unequal distribution of the electron density. So there is a more negative charge on chlorine atoms and a more positive charge is located on phosphorus. That's why we can name the PCl bond polar, and we can indicate it by using arrows or deltas as shown on the slide. Just a rule of thumb is that the greater the electronegativity difference between the atoms, the more polar the covalent bond between them is. Well done! Now we know how to determine if a bond is polar or nonpolar, and the ways to graphically depict it. As usual, here's the exercise for you to solve. Determine if the bonds are polar or nonpolar. If the bond is polar, then attribute the partial charges using deltas or arrows. Pause the video and solve it. Here are the right answers. Check yourself. If you have any questions or mistakes, feel free to ask your questions in the corresponding threads on our forum. Most of the questions will be discussed during the webinars. The last topic we'll discuss today is the dipole moment. This property defines if the whole compound is polar or nonpolar based on the information about its structure and bond types. The dipole moment is important for organic chemists because using it, we can determine which solvents our compound is soluble. It is reasonable to begin with the standard definition from physics. The electric dipole moment is a measure of the separation of positive and negative electrical charges within a system, that is a measure of the system's overall polarity. In other words, when two electrical charges of opposite sign are separated by a distance, an electric dipole is established. As we have already seen, the electrons aren't distributed equally within a molecule due to differences in the electronegativity of the constituent atoms. It means that a diatomic molecule can form a dipole and should be treated as an electric dipole. The dipole moment of a diatomic molecule is given by the equation on the slide right now. Here, the letter D is the distance between point charges, and for chemists, it is just the internuclear distance or covalent bond length. E is the charge of one electron, and its value can be seen on the screen now. Lastly, the letter Q is the magnitude of the point charge. The dipole moment itself is denoted with the Greek letter mu. The SI unit of mu is the coulomb meter, but for convenience, mu is usually given in units of debye. As I have already mentioned, the point's charges on atoms denoted with the letter Q arise from bond polarity, and they are equal to magnitude of the partial atomic charges that we have just discussed. For a better understanding of this concept, let's solve together a problem given on the slide. The bond length in HF is 92 pm and the dipole moment is 183 debye. Determine the partial atomic charges in the molecule. First, let's rewrite the dipole moment formula with the respect to the point charge Q. Q equals the dipole moment divided by electron charge and the internuclear distance. Now we can calculate the charge distribution by substituting variables with the previously given data. Well done. Here you can see the calculated value of Q. It means that we can attribute the positive partial charge of magnitude Q to hydrogen and the negative partial charge of magnitude Q to fluorine. Pay attention that the molecule itself is not charged, meaning that the overall charge is zero. But the world would be much simpler if all quantities were scalar. Unfortunately, it's not. And the dipole moment is a vector quantity, meaning that it has a direction in space. And what do we use to show direction? Hell yeah, vectors. So the dipole moment of a polyatomic molecule is a vector, and it can be calculated with the formula represented on the screen. Here the Qi is the magnitude of the ith charge, and Ri is the vector representing the position of the ith charge. Of course, we can assume that the charges have the same coordinates as the atomic nuclei, meaning by iterating over I, you iterate over atoms. Okay, first we need to define the origin of the coordinate system. The theory states that if the molecule is neutral, then the choice of the center does not influence the resulting dipole moment. Second, we should determine the coordinates of all atoms in our molecule and represent them in a vector form as shown on the screen now. I recommend you to pause the video and inspect the slide carefully. Take your time and make your notes. It should enhance your memorizing significantly. Lastly, we need to use the Q values and use the initially given formula for a dipole moment of a polyatomic molecule. Let us calculate the dipole moment of water, knowing all the data about geometry and charges. First, locate the center of the coordinate system on the oxygen atom. Then the R3 vector is zero. Then we determine the vectors for both hydrogen atoms. The results are also given on the slide. Pay attention to the fact that vectors R1 and R2 point from hydrogens to oxygen. This is a general rule that the vectors should point towards the more electronegative element that bears partial negative charge. In this case, the oxygen atom depicted in pink. Then let's multiply the vectors R1 and R2 by the corresponding charges denoted with Q. The last step is the summation of vectors R1 and R2, followed by finding the length of the resulting vector. The length of a resulting vector is 1.2 angstrom, and the direction is shown in the figure with the blue vector. This is the direction of the overall dipole moment of the water molecule. Lastly, to calculate the dipole moment of the water molecule, we need to multiply the vector length by charge separation 0.33, then by elementary charge E depicted in green, and then convert the obtained value in debye as shown in figure in violet. Okay, the calculated dipole moment of water is 191 debye, which is very close to the experimentally determined value of 1.87 debye. From the answer, we can deduce that water is a polar molecule, and it can be used to dissolve other polar substances. If the dipole moment is zero, then the molecule is said to be nonpolar. Pause the video and try to choose nonpolar molecules based only on their geometries and constituent atoms. Done? Here are the right answers. As you can see, both CCl4 and CS2 molecules are nonpolar despite the polar covalent bonds present in them. The reason is the vector nature of a dipole moment. In these molecules, the vectors that describe CCl and CS polar bonds point in different directions but have equal magnitudes as shown on the slide. That's why their summation leads to zero overall dipole moment. So these molecules are nonpolar, and they can be used as solvents for other nonpolar substances. Ultimately, the dipole moment depends on both on the electronegativity of the elements and on the geometry of the molecule. Well, that's it for today. Let's make a brief overview of what we have discussed. First, we familiarized ourselves with the concept of covalent bond length. It helped us to describe several ways of defining the atomic radius, such as Bohr radius, covalent radius, and van der Waals radius. The next topic we discussed was the polarity of a covalent bond. Now you know that the covalent bond can be either polar or nonpolar, and you can determine it using the electronegativity of participating atoms. Obviously, using this feature, we had pretty enough information to talk about the dipole moment, its importance for chemists, and the ways of calculating it. If you have any questions related to this video or any other topic in chemistry, biochemistry, or pharmaceutical sciences, you're more than welcome to ask them on our website and forum or in the comments below this video. We'll be glad if you give us a like and subscribe to our channel. Thank you very much, and we'll meet once again in the next video.